I believe that I have alerted you to the fact, we thank our sanctuary choir for that beautiful number. I think I've alerted you to the fact that in February I'll be shifting my emphasis to focus on the family. On February 4, my opening sermon will be entitled, My Biggest Problem in Marriage is Me. February 11th, Marriage, God's Idea. February 25th, Till Death Do Us Part, or Something Else. I've not decided what the fourth sermon will be yet, but I'm working on it. I had a person say to me, and it was an uninformed comment based on an assumption that is not true. They said, Pastor, when you preach on marriage, are you going to say anything about singles? You can't preach on marriage without talking about singles. Last time I looked, marriage is the combination of two single people. So everybody will be touched by these sermons. I will say this to you, though, as kind of a foretaste of those sermons. If I had to make a choice between being married and miserable and single and miserable, I would choose single and miserable. Because at least you can still make a choice. That's just a tidbit from February. So bring your friends, family, pals, and buddies for the sermons in February. I took note of something on the bulletin. You note we're showing a loss in offering and a loss in tithe. Loss in offering is expected when you have two straight days. This is the first Sabbath of the year. We haven't had bad weather. So a loss in offering is not that surprising. I do not tolerate a loss in tithe unless a bunch of us have lost our jobs. Then tithe ought to remain the same or greater. What do you say? Amen. So be sure that you're faithful in returning online. We'll be fine as the weather treats us better. Now to our sermon for today, One Blood. One Blood. I'd like to recognize the presence of our former student pastor, Pastor Preston Willis, is back with us. With his father. Please stand. Let's welcome them. Pastor Willis will be back with us in May or June, May, to continue to be a part of our church family. Now, the day's sermon is serious. One Blood. Let's pray. Guide us, Lord, into this word. In Jesus' name, amen. Theme for the year is what? Talk to me. The theme for the year is what? And for the first quarter, the theme is one community. Say that. Last week in Well, 2 weeks ago in part one of these early sermons, we learned that oneness amongst people, even God's people, is not easily achieved. In other words, we don't naturally get along. We just don't. We found out the problem of division, Brother Francis, amongst Christian believers and amongst people in general started in heaven. That was shocking, D'Angelo, for us to find out. Shocking to discover that in heaven, I need you to be upset with me, I said in heaven, foolishness and division got started. Therefore, we've emphasized without apology, if they couldn't get along in glory, you know we ain't getting along down here. But we also said that it's God's love that permits not getting along. In His holiness and love of peace, God will not make people, even angels, get along. He wants you to choose unity. We learned then that this insidious spirit of division and competition moved to earth. And we saw that there were just two human beings, and after sin they could not get along. We saw it spread from tribe to tribe and kingdom to kingdom. And the problem is sin. What's the problem? Sin. It is sin. When you're not getting along with anybody in that moment, sin is at work. And don't be so pious as to decide that the problem is on the other person. You'll discover in my first sermon in February that the biggest problem you got is you. Nobody can make you angry. So when you say, she made me angry, you're lying. You chose to get angry. I need a loud amen. And so sin's the problem. So we went on to discover, just reviewing, so what I always do when I preach, just review, that this problem became so prevalent that even when Jesus began to form His church, His apostles, they could not get along. And we saw with great agony how even after 3.5 years with Jesus, they still couldn't get along. Then we learned in the sermon last week that one of the things Christ wants to do to bring unity to us of spirit is to bring us to the foot of the cross. We found out that the cross represents the humility of God. And we discovered, Pastor Oddly, that if we want to duplicate in the church the unity of heaven, we must have the humbleness of heaven. To accept the reality that I'm not better than anybody. I knew nobody would say amen. Folk, that is a false teaching of humanity. All these different levels we have of met, you are not better than anybody. You're not better than the drunk. You're not better than the dope addict. You're not better because God, Christ, died for them all. He put the same value on every sinner. We must get rid of these hierarchies. Now today, we want to look at this concept of one blood. Mankind is of one blood. Go back to the text that Brother Avondale, young man, did an outstanding job. Made you get quiet first, where he read the text, stood there with dignity, and then he read the Word of God. And he read John, he read Genesis 1:26. Then God said, let us make man how? Do you realize what an amazing text that is? Commenting on this, Ellen G. White says, that the human race is a unique creation. She wasn't just talking about comparing us with the animals and birds and beasts on earth. In the universe, there's no other species on any planet created like us. We were made in the image of God. Unique creation. In fact, she goes on to say in letter 92 that if man had not sinned, God would have used some of us to replace the angels in heaven. Come on, y'all. Why don't you turn to somebody right now and say, I am somebody. Go on and say it. Go on and say it. You know you something. God going to use you to replace angels. You know you got some tough roots in your body. I'm going to get to preaching directly. In his image. It's a powerful text. In the image of God made he him. The next verse says male and female. Created he them. Divided himself up. And so a woman is as much in the image of God as a man. Let the brethren say amen. In fact, Patriarchs and Prophets, page 58 says, if man, before man sinned, man and woman were equal. So equal expressions of God. And then we learned, young man read that text, Acts 17:26, God hath made of one blood. How many bloods? One blood. I don't care what race, I don't care what culture, I don't care what color. When we bleed, we all bleed red. Isn't that something? So we are one. Now, here's the text he did not read, Malachi 2:10. Malachi 2:10. Go there real quick. Last book in the Old Testament. Malachi 2 and verse 10. I wanted you to get this text. Oh, they got it up there. We can read it from the screen. Come on. Everybody, have we not all? I need your help. Have we not all one Father? Has not one God created us? Look at it. Why do we deal treacherously one with another by profaning the covenant of the fathers? The Bible is in shock. How dare you treat somebody else treacherously or less or badly when we all have one Father? The Bible can't believe we would do that. So the oneness of man is all over the Bible, even after the flood. Went down from 8 million down to 8 folks, just 8 folks. The Bible says clearly in Genesis 10:32, out of those 3 sons, Ham, Shem, and Japheth, God repopulated the earth. So all of us are descendants from at least one of them sons. And if you ain't, you got a serious problem. Now, here's what we found out, though. After those 3 sons begin to repopulate the earth, there begin to be a decline in the human race. For instance, after the flood, Noah was the oldest man on the earth after the flood. Lived to be 950. No one after that even came close to that age. His longest living son lived about 500 years. And by the time you get down to the end of chapter 11, they're all living less than 200 years. So, listen to me. Oneness in the image of God, oneness in sin, oneness in decline. Over there in Great Controversy, she talks about when we all join together in heaven. And Adam sees what has happened to us. See, Adam is more than twice as tall as our tallest man. Adam's about 14 feet tall. We get excited. We see someone 7 feet tall. Adam was a huge dude. And she says that when Adam sees us, he's going to cry. Look at this. Some of us think we're fine and cute. Adam's going to say, what? These are my great... Sin has depleted us and brought us low. So we're oneness, even our decline. See where I'm going with this? See, if we want to decline, how can we talk about anybody? Everybody is shriveled up, messed up. The prettiest ones of us are ugly. Sister, you think you're fine? Wait till you see Eve. You're going to crawl in a hole. There was a fine sister. You know, the Bible does not say she was created. The Hebrew says she was built. Bible says, out of Adam's rib, he built a woman. Somebody say amen out there. Hallelujah for built. Let the brothers rejoice for 5 seconds. I'm trying to tell you that we have become diminished. In all ways, we become diminished. And so, it's interesting to note that not only was there decline physically, there was a decline, and I found as I was preparing this, I reviewed it, the decline of man. Now, I don't want anybody to get upset. The decline of man physically, Sister Curdell, seems to have come as soon as man started eating meat. Yeah, Kentucky Fried Wendy's did us in. Our age went down. Man's original diet was fruits, nuts, and grains. Wholesome food, keeping the colon clean, and disease could not live there. All right. So decline physically, decline in age. There was another decline. Here are some statements. Brethren, put those statements up there. I want the church to see these statements that I got from Ellen White's writings about the intelligence of Adam and Eve as compared to us today. Have you got those? Yeah. No. Here we go. Yeah, you got it. Yes, here it is. Look at this. Read. Come on. The Lord God blessed Adam and Eve with intelligence such as he had not given. They were smart. You know, Adam did not need a book. In fact, there's no record of books till after the flood. They lived 800-900 years, didn't forget nothing. Put the next statement up there. Yeah. Here you go, read. There perished in the flood greater inventions of art and human skill. You remember about 30, 40 years ago, they found these drawings over there in Thailand of flying ships. The drawings were over 4,000 years old. We don't know what those antediluvians could do. We have no idea. And the Lord wiped it all out. We're just getting back to where they were. We think we're smart. Huge people. Lived for centuries. Can you imagine? And they used all of their brain. So we've diminished even into... Read the next one. Get the next one up there. Yeah. Read this. If men could know... Everybody, if men could know how many arts have been lost to our world, they would not talk... So in strength of intellect, men who now live can bear no comparison to the ancients. So here we are, made in God's image. Sin came in, declined physically, declined in age, declined intellectually. Decline in health, decline in accomplishments, decline in intelligence. And then decline in character. It's always amazing to me when I read the Bible to discover, Joy, that the best of us have a lot of bad in us. Now, we call Abraham the father of what? The faithful. Abraham would lie. You do know he would lie. And he didn't learn from his lies. He told a lie about his wife and 20 years later told the same lie for the same reason. Now, notice how character is passed on. Isaac lied about the same thing. We find Abraham's lie in Genesis 12, Genesis 20. Isaac tells the same lie, that's his son, in Genesis 26. And then Jacob. He went further than lying. He was a deceiver, a con man. Are you with me? And then, when you look at the 12 sons of Jacob. Now think about what the pastor's saying. We're getting worse and worse character-wise. Look at the things going on in our society. People will do anything. You know I'm telling the truth. It leaves us shocked at the depravity and the boldness with which people do wrong. I'm setting you up. I'm setting you up. So here we are, of one blood, but unified in decline, age, health, size, character. In fact, in Psalm 14, verses 1 and 3, the Bible says, there is none that doeth good. No, not one. Not now. So if there's decline, you can ask it later. If there's decline in all of this, why would Jesus want to become human? Hey! Or, if you're going to become human, David Court, why don't you become human during the antediluvian era? Be easier to be righteous then. Then you could live 400 or 500 years and really show and demonstrate. Why would you wait to show up down here? There are two chapters in the Bible that reveal God's plan. Matthew 1 and Luke 3. Go to Matthew 1. I want to show you something amazing about Jesus. Now, Matthew 1 gives the lineage of Jesus through Joseph. Did Jesus have any of Joseph's blood and flesh? Luke 3 gives the lineage of Jesus through Mary. Now here's what's important. If you're reading the two lineages, the ancestry of Mary and Joseph join at David. Mary is a descendant from David through Nathan, his son born in Jerusalem. Joseph is a descendant of David through Solomon. Are you with me? So from David back, they have the same ancestry. Are you listening to me? When you read the lineage of Jesus in the book of Matthew, it blows your mind. Now, I don't know about you. I have some shady relatives in my past. Can I get a witness anywhere? On my mother's side, I've got a grandfather who knocked his slave master silly, ran from Kentucky across the Ohio River, and came to Ohio. On my grandfather's side, I got a great-great-great-great-grandfather who used to travel up from Virginia to Pennsylvania every year and sell cattle for his boss. These trips were made with the boss's daughter. One trip, they did not return. Now, you could match me with stories yourself. And whether you want to admit it or not, we tend to be influenced by our relatives. I'm going to take it further. Even if you don't know it and admit it, you got stuff in you passed on to you by your grandparents that you've wrestled with all your life. In some cases, you don't even know where it came from. Can I get a witness? Desire of Ages says that Jesus waited until the bodies of human beings were inhabited by demons. Hey! He waited until 4,000 years of degeneration had taken place. And decided to become one blood with us when we were at our worst. When you read Matthew's record, you find some interesting people. Look at verse 3, chapter 1. Judah begot Peres and Zerah by Tamar. You know that story? That beats any soap opera on TV. She was married to his son died. Then she married another son, he died. The law said that Judah should give her to the next son. He didn't do it. So Tamar goes and dresses up. Man, this would make a movie. Goes and dresses up like a harlot. Sits on the side of the road. You remember the story? Judah, who's married, stops by for a little business on a business trip. You know, why do we watch movies? Read the Bible. Read the Bible. Hooks up with what he thinks is a harlot. It's his daughter-in-law. Time to pay. He ain't got the money. She says, that's all right. Leave me your signet stick, something. And then you bring it back. So she trusts him. He trusts her. Comes back. Can't find her. In the meantime, word gets to him that his daughter-in-law is pregnant. Well, this stuff is in the Bible. Why are you reading Penthouse? Just read the Bible. You don't need no novels. Read God's word. He tells it like it is. He finds out his daughter-in-law is pregnant. He's going to get all rousty and righteous now, going to go down there and stone her. She says, come on down. Just come on down. We have to talk about it. Gets down, and she says, who's the man? She says, she holds up his stick. I'd like to have been there and seen his face. The man who's the baby, father of this baby, is the owner of this stick. Oh, he said, that's my stick. She's an ancestress of Jesus. Come on, y'all. She's not Jewish. It's important to know that our Lord, Lord help me preach this thing, when our Lord took on the human family, he didn't choose any race or cultural tongue. He let the bloodlines be spread around in his flesh. Then if you think that's something, the next one that shows up, verse 5, is Salmon begets Boaz by Rahab. Now, Solomon was a great-great-grandson of Peres. He lived at the time that the Israelites destroyed Jericho. He married Rahab. You know who Rahab was? This was a successful prostitute. So successful, she owned a house on the wall. She was a property owner. So successful that the king went to inquire of her about the spies. Now notice, he didn't bust in the door looking for her. He inquired, indicating her high standing in the courts of the king. Maybe some nightly visits there. See, just read the Bible, folk. Just read it. And he marries her. Out of her comes Boaz. So now we got Rahab. And by Rahab was a Jerichoite. And the Jerichoites were black people. Why don't y'all get quiet? See, I'm talking about my Savior Jesus. I'm telling you that when he came and took on the flesh of human beings, he was not choosy. He got everybody involved. Why? He knew one day Henry Wright would need a Savior that could understand him. But it doesn't stop there. It doesn't stop there. Salmon begat Boaz by Rahab, and Boaz begat Obed by Ruth. You know who Ruth was? I wish y'all would read your Bible. Ruth was a Moabitess. You know who the Moabites are? The Moabites are a race of people that came into existence through incest. You remember that Lot survived the city of Sodom? Remember that? Took his two daughters with him, and they finally got into the cave in the mountain. These two daughters had been so soiled morally by living in Sodom, they got their father drunk, took turns. Each had a son. The oldest daughter had a son named Moab, who produced a race of people that hated the Jews. Ruth came from that line and became the great-great-grandmother of David. Now you see why David was born with issues. See, folk, you need to read the Bible with more intelligence. David didn't just become immoral because he was born. All this stuff is in the lines. All this stuff is in the lines. All this stuff is in the lines. And my God said, look at here. If I don't come at a time when I can pick up all the dirt, I can't be their Savior. If I don't come at a time when their flesh is so contorted that there is no way they can be saved except by the power of... If I don't come and get all the garbage in the human pail, then I cannot be there. So I'm going to wait till all that mess piles up. Then I'll become human. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. It's all there. It's all there. So all this stuff is in there. And all these people were ancestresses of Mary. And my Bible tells me that Jesus was born in the womb of Mary. Can't you see them waiting? Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. They decided being born in the days of the Antediluvians would not be salvific enough. They looked at David and his generation. They maybe thought about coming then, but hadn't got as worse as he could get. They just kept waiting. In fact, the Bible describes it this way. It says, when the fullness of time was come. The Greek says, when time got pregnant, Jesus showed up. Because Christ knew that we, being of one blood, some of y'all got tempers, some of y'all got weaknesses, some of y'all got diseases, some of us have tendencies, some of us have attitudes, some of us have been born with congenital messed up stuff. And Jesus said, I have to be their Savior. Therefore, I'm going to wait till it means something. Nobody's going to tell me I wasn't a good Savior. I'm going to be born with the feeling of their infirmities. Yet, I shall be without sin. So, Henry Wright will know no matter what he inherited by the power of God, he can overcome any tendency in his body. Hallelujah!
Thank you, Father. I'm going to wait till there's no excuse. So they all know if they pray and rely on the Holy Ghost, if they trust in me, I don't care what you've inherited. You can walk the streets of gold, put on a long white robe. Why? You got Jesus in you, and that's enough. Doesn't make any difference who your grandpa was. Makes no difference who your grandma was. If you got Jesus as your brother, God as your father, you can be saved. Let me tell one of my old stories. I'm riding in the plane. I do a lot of flying for the sake of the gospel. Because I'm a light-skinned Negro, somebody cautioned me about using that word in my sermons, but I am a Negro. It makes some people a little confused. Hair is nappy, skin is white. Nappy hair, white skin. So the brother's sitting next to me on the plane. And I'm reading my Bible, what I always do on the plane. And notice he keeps looking at me. So finally, I gave him a look that says, you got a problem? And he realized I'm a little irritated. He says, oh, I'm sorry. Didn't mean to be offended. He said, but I don't know how to say this, but that. He said, what are you? This happened. Well, I inherited, see, inheritance, my mother's quick tongue. I looked at him, I said, Homo sapien. Planet Earth, where are you from? He said, oh, I really have offended you. I said, no. He said, you see, you know, he said, we can trace our ancestry back to the boat. So my ancestors came over on the Mayflower. I said, oh, so did my ancestors. He said, oh, Mayflower. I said, no. Noah's Ark. And I said, if your ancestors didn't make that boat, you got more problems than I got. My father is God. Come on, somebody. My brother is Jesus. Come on, somebody. My line. See, what I like about Mary's ancestry, Joseph's ancestry stops at Abraham, but Mary's ancestry goes all the way back to Adam. That's the only thing that counts. One blood, one people, one race. One race. One race. Human race. Made in the image of God. And Jesus said, I love them so much, I cannot resist who they are, what they become. I will identify with them. And so Desire of Ages celebrates the union by saying, he shall forever, page 25, bear human nature, have human form. I got relatives in high places. It's the blood of Jesus that makes us one. One blood, one people, one set of sins, Brody, one set of sins. We all got the same problems. I got liars in my family, you got liars in yours. Come on, y'all. You got cheats in your family, I got cheats in mine. I got folks in my family that philandered around, you got some yourself. Some of us were born as a result of that philandering around, but that's all right. They questioned Jesus' birth all his life because Mary came in with the baby a little bit early. Can't be Joseph's baby. A shadow over him. He did all he could to identify with the human race. Thank you, Father. I don't have to apologize for anything in my bloodlines. Jesus took it on. The blood. It's the blood that makes us one. Come on and say, let's sing the song. Everybody stand. Lead us in that song, my brother. The blood, the blood, the blood. Sing it. I need to hear you.
The blood.
Sing it.
That Jesus shed for me.
Praise his name. Praise his name.
Somebody is standing here and you don't even know who your father is. Luke 3 says you got one. His name is Adam. And Luke says Adam was the son of God. So you got a father. Somebody may be standing here, has no family. Nobody you know about. I got news for you. You got a brother. His name is Jesus. Come on, somebody. Put your hands together and give Jesus glory. Bow your heads, close your eyes. Maybe somebody today came seeking for the assurance of acceptance. Your life has been kind of a crooked road in the church, out of the church, sometimes up, sometimes down. Or you've never really accepted the truth of the Savior. Jesus, the Son of God. You've never said yes to the Christian church. And you'd like to come down today. Maybe you need to study more. Maybe you're ready even for baptism or rebaptism. I don't know. But before we close this service, I'm going to give you an opportunity to move from where you are and come down and present yourself on this front pew to Jesus. Your Lord, your Savior, your brother. Is there one who will come? You're praying, church. You're praying. From the balcony, from down on the main floor, you'll come. You're praying. You're not looking. You're praying. When the call is made, the job of the church is to pray. Let the Holy Spirit do His work. Is there one who will come? God bless you, my friend. God bless you. Please have a seat. You sure that you don't want to come? Let's pray. You can slip down. Pastor Smith is coming. He'll take your hand. Our Father, we leave with our spirits lifted. We said it earlier in the sermon, I am somebody. I'm so special that heaven took on the worst of us in its own flesh and became my Savior in human flesh, conquered sin in human flesh. I leave lifted. Oh, I still got issues. I still got problems, and I'll probably mess up before the week is over, but I know now I got a Savior. When I talk to Him, He says, I understand. Felt it. And Lord, that gives me hope. And I thank You for it. For this precious soul who has come, Thou knowest why. I pray now Your mercy and Your grace. In Jesus' name. And all the people said, Amen. You may be seated. Are you glad you came to church today? Praise God.